Hello and welcome. My name is Thorsten Tiet. I'm the founder of Dividend Stocks Cash, a stock screener making long-term profit growth visible to anyone. Long-term profit growth you need to benefit from growing capital gains and growing dividends as well. In one of my last videos, I was talking about the FANG stocks and we took a look at the valuation of each stock and we have seen that the any of these stocks was overvalued, but that the overvaluation in the current correction of the market has dissipated for the most, and we already see some FANG stocks, for example Facebook, which are attractively valued if you believe in the model of the respective company. Today we are going to take a look at the Chinese tech stocks. It's a BAT stocks, they are called, or Baidu, Alibaba and Tencent. We are taking a look at each of this company, and before we do so, we are talking about investing in China in general. But to get the big picture about the companies we are going to talk, let's go into the screener. I created a watch list, and in this watch list, I added our Chinese stocks, our Chinese tech stocks, to the FANG stocks to give you an impression about this of their size. Let's change the ranking. So before it was a dividend based ranking, now we have a profit growth based ranking. Let's sort by descending order by market capitalization. Then we see that the three largest company, AAA, is Alibaba, Amazon and Alphabet, with market capitalization between 720 and 750 billion US dollar. They are very close to each other and the order can change anytime. Then we have a second group with market capitalization between 350 and 76.7 billion, also very close together. And here we see the two big Chinese companies, Tencent and Alibaba, about the same market capitalization. Then we at the end, we have Netflix and Baidu. We see that the dividends are rarely paid. It's just Apple and Tencent paying dividends. And Tencent at least already 13 years consecutive dividend increase, but their dividend yield is rather low, at least compared to other stocks and compared to Apple as well. The green columns here are more important for our tech stocks because this is the profit growth quantified by earnings, operating cash flows and revenues in this case. And we see that we have increase rates within the last 5 years double digit increase rates between 80 and more than 100%. And if you take a look at the operating cash flow, you see above the same double digit growth rates. Netflix makes the exception with negative operating cash flow. I covered this in the last FANG video. And revenues increase as well. Now let's go to the Chinese market, investing in Chinese stocks in general, or especially in Chinese tech stocks. There is a problem in China and it's related to discrimination of foreign investors in the Chinese government separates the industry in four segments, and there are two segments where it's unlikely that you can invest directly in Chinese stocks. It's if the company is in a prohibited segment or in a restricted segment. And all these companies here we are interested in, they are internet service companies, and internet is a restricted industry in China. This means you can't directly invest into it. But the company founders found ways how you can invest indirectly, and this is done using variable interest entities. And I will show you how this looks like. Here is the annual report of Alibaba 2018, and they show how this construct looks like in a little simplified manner. And these rebel interest entities, they are, as far as I know, always apply. So Tencent, Alibaba, Baidu, and other internet companies, they do the same to get their hands on foreign capital. What we as investors, as foreign investors, we invest in a company which is outside of China. This is the Alibaba Group Holdings Limited on the Cayman Islands in the case of Alibaba. And this is a shell, this is a proxy. It owns 100% of another company inside China, which does not operate in a restricted industry. And this company has contracts with the company we are really interested in, with the company who's really generating the cash, the real Baidu, the real Tencent, the real Alibaba, if you want. And thanks to some contracts, all the cash these companies, the operating companies, generates belongs to the wholly foreign owned company, which belongs to the company we invest in, which is our company, which is the Alibaba Group Holding Limited on the Cayman Islands in the case of Alibaba, or somewhere in the Caribbean also in the case of Baidu, and so on. If you want to make someone afraid of investing in China, you just tell him that this is a special construct and that it operates in a gray area, and that the Chinese government can always stop this to work, and that you most probably will use your complete investment in this case. So this from a legal point, I think this is true, but the question is if this is realistic or not. Every investor needs to decide this on his own. I have my own opinion. I believe these constructs are here to stay, or they may be changed, but the Chinese government won't declare it as invalid and take away all your stocks. Because in this case, the most successful Chinese internet companies would lose all access to foreign investors, and new companies couldn't count on new money from abroad. So it would be very detrimental to the Chinese economy. On the other hand, this discrimination, or the discrimination of foreign investors, we also profit directly from this. Why? Because it favors Chinese companies against their foreign concurrents. You can't, as a big company, doesn't matter how much money you own, you can't directly easily invest in China. You need to create joint ventures, to work together with the Chinese government, and so on. This is a big advantage of Chinese companies, because the market is not completely, but there's a hurdle to take for foreign investors. Another point is censorship. There exists the Great Chinese Wall, and this Great Chinese Wall, firewall, it favors Chinese companies too, because you can't host all the servers as a foreign company. It's a bad idea if you host your servers, for example, in the United States. It's a mistake, for example, eBay did when they tried to compete against Alibaba and lost, because they were buying a Chinese company, and then they took off all the IT from China, or the IT infrastructure of the website eBay China from China to the United States, San Jose. And after they did this, Chinese eBay users complained about sluggish website and about technical errors, because the Great Chinese Firewall slows down the traffic from abroad when scanning the traffic using algorithms. And because they use algorithms, you can't always be sure, or you can't be sure at all, which data will be censored and which data goes through. So this creates unpredictable behavior, resulting in technical errors on the website hosted abroad. So this is also a big advantage of Chinese companies against their competitors from abroad. And then there's Chinese in general, a very special market. For example, when Google tried to compete with Baidu, they had some problems to adjust, develop their search algorithms for the Chinese language, and Baidu did better than Google did. And there's also a different perception of what looks good and what looks bad of the Chinese compared to the Western approach. For example, if you look at Taobao, then you might think that the website is overcrowded, but for the Chinese eye, this seems to be just good. And then there is another point, it's the infrastructure. So we could say that especially Alibaba and Tencent are much more mighty than their counterparts in the developed countries like Google and Amazon, because they created what they call the Iron Triangle. This means they did not only create a website, for example, in the case of Alibaba, an eBay-like website where you can sell and buy your stuff, but they also needed to create a payment service because it did not exist before they came. There, you weren't able to buy with credit cards, for example, in the Chinese market. And that's why they needed to invent something. And they use Alipay and TenPay, and that was necessary for buyers and sellers to make their transactions. And Amazon, for example, did not need to invent Amazon Pay for online transactions to take place. And Alibaba especially also needed to take care about the logistics, that the goods which were bought and sold could go from the seller to the buyer as well. If you are coming from abroad and if you want to compete with Alibaba or Tencent, for example, then you need also to take care about payment services and logistics as well, because you can't rely on third-party companies doing all this for you. You need to make a lot of this on your own. So to conclude, the economic moat of these Chinese companies is much deeper than of the Western counterparts, in my point of view. And then there's something else why you might invest in one of these companies. That's the growth, the expected growth also in the future. We see here the Chinese internet penetration rate, and it's just below 60% in 2017. Now it's maybe 60%, but it still means that 4 out of 10 Chinese still wait to be connected to the internet and still wait to become customer of Alibaba, Tencent, and probably Baidu too. And the other 6 Chinese, they profit from the growth of the economy, about still more than 6% growth rate right now, as far as I know, which is 2 to 3 times higher than in the developed countries, which means that they can spend more money in the future, most probably. So the expected growth of these Chinese companies is much higher than it is for our companies. Then let's go back to the screener, and we now take a look at Baidu. We will make a second part where we take a look at Tencent and Alibaba, because otherwise the video gets too long. So let's take a look at Baidu. Baidu is the smallest of all these companies, and Baidu, like Google, makes all its money with advertising. So they have a Google-like search engine, and all their money comes through this, through online search, and or 80% of their advertising revenue is done by online search or generated by online search. And they also have other services we all know from the Western companies as well. They have a kind of YouTube, which creates 20% of revenue, about, also coming from advertising. They also have online payment, they also have a cloud service, they also have an app store where you can buy apps, which I don't know. But the revenue is still generated, like in the case of Alphabet, Google, from advertising, and 80% by using this online search, and 20% with this China YouTube, okay, let's call it like this. And it's the same case for Alphabet. The Alphabet has different segments, but they have only one segment making cash, and all the others are just, you can say, bets on the future. And If we now take a look here about the long-term profit growth, then we see that there is growth. We using well, quantified by reported earnings and by operating cash flow as well. We see here that for the last 12 trading months there is no operating cash flow, because in the quarterly reports probably this isn't contained. Here you see the revenues, which increase as well. And what's interesting is if you take a look at the earnings, then there are some spikes and ups and downs. So there is no, it's not a steady increase, like for example in the case of Tencent. And if you have so some outliers or spikes, then it's very probable for the earnings that something extraordinary happened, something not operational happened, and in this case attributed to additional earnings. And this suspicion is affirmed by taking a look at the margins. We see here that the net margin is well above the operating margin in 2015, this spike, and also in the latest data and starting with 2017, it's the same. So it's this spike here. And this generates a problem. Without this, the earnings would look a little bit more steadily like this. And with the spikes, it looks like this. And why may this disturb? It might disturb because it makes valuation of the stock a little bit harder. We have here some fair values, and if you just read the fair value of the last 12 trading months, then first you see that the operating cash flow is missing because it wasn't reported here. And second, you see that the fair value based on earnings is very, very high, is too high because of this spike. And if you want to get an idea about the fair valuation of the company, dividends aren't paid, so we can't use this. And then we have another version, fair value growth. But we omit this for simplification purposes. If you want to get an idea about the valuation using one of these two methods, then we can still go on. But to do so, we need to get an idea about the fair price earnings or the regular price earnings of the stock. For this to do, we take a look at the years where the earnings were representative. It's 2012, 2013, 2014, 2016, 2017, for example. So 2017 with price earnings of 26, 37, and then here about 25. So in my point of view, you could say that the 25 is an price earnings is a number which is about the is a representative number of the past. And if we compare this to a representative number of the present, we can't do because it's not representative. We must go to 2019. It's an estimate. And if we take this 2019, we say that the price earnings are 18. And if we compare 18 to 25, we see that we have a difference of 7 points price earnings. And if we go up here, we see that earnings per share are about, let's say, $9 multiplied with 7 points is 63, is $63. So, and if we now go to 2019, because we did this for 2019, then you could say $63 undervaluation we have here. So the fair value of the stock in 2019 would be $159 plus 63, which is about 123, if I right calculated correctly, at $223. So you could say that Baidu is heavily undervalued right now. If these estimates come true, or rather these estimates here, it's because we used earnings per share. And you can do the same for the operating cash flow. So Baidu seems to be attractively valued. We just make a little preview. If you take a look at Tencent, for example, then we see that the valuation is much, much easier to do. But we also have here some distortion, but it relates probably only the reported earnings. So we now have a basic understanding about the investment in China and about Baidu a little bit more in depth. I hope you like the video. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Goodbye.